Virgin 1 has finally reached orbit with their air launch to orbit system. But what does that mean, and why don't we do this for all rockets? Let's talk about that today.
Go for deploy. 100 feet, lift to the right, roll. Hold back
right. Hey guys, Tori here from Overlook Horizon. On Sunday, January 17th, Virgin Orbit successfully launched their Launcher 1 platform into low Earth orbit. This was only their second demonstration flight, and it carried a total of 10 small CubeSats into orbit, and as far as I can tell, they nailed it. Now, this is obviously better than the first time around, which failed shortly after launch when one of the liquid oxygen lines actually broke and the engine was no longer receiving oxygen and it was ultimately terminated. Although they never showed us video of that, I've heard it was a pretty fiery descent. Now, Virgin Orbit's Launcher 1 platform is pretty unique because it's the first air launch orbital rocket that is liquid fueled. Now, we've had an air launch rocket sent into orbit before. That's the Northrop Grumman Pegasus rocket, but that's a solid fueled rocket, which is a little different than Virgin Orbit's liquid fueled rocket, which uses RP-1 kerosene and liquid oxygen, just like, say, the SpaceX's Falcon 9. Now, an air launch system is essentially a rocket that's mounted to the underside of a wing on a giant airplane. It takes off from a runway, the plane will perform a number of checkouts before pointing the rocket in the right direction and then dropping it. At that point, the engines would ignite and it would be on its way to orbit. Now, the main advantage to an air launch rocket system is obviously starting your rocket at higher altitude. But a lot of people think that this is because it has a head start and it's closer to space, so you're almost there, right? Well, not exactly. Remember, to get to space, you go up, but to stay in space, you go sideways, very fast. And it's this sideways movement that's actually the bigger task. The big advantage, really, is that you start your rocket engines above the dense part of the atmosphere, which is at lower altitudes. The thicker atmosphere means the rocket has to work harder against things like atmospheric drag. Also, you can get better performance out of your rocket by having an engine nozzle that doesn't have to worry about sea level atmosphere. I'm sure you've seen this on, say, like the SpaceX's new Raptor engines, where the sea level engine nozzle is much smaller than the engine nozzle that's designed for stages that only operate in the vacuum of space. Now, what the nozzle of a rocket engine is trying to do is to cram the exhaust gas through a throat to create high pressure, and then allow it to expand quickly back to low pressure to create supersonic high-speed exhaust. The thing is, you want the pressure of your exhaust at the end of the nozzle to match the ambient air pressure for the best efficiency, and that's why sea level engine nozzles are smaller to match the ambient higher pressure there at sea level. Now, compare that to the vacuum of space, where you want the exhaust to expand much further, since there's virtually no pressure in space. If your engine bell is sized too small for the ambient environment, the exhaust will expand further outside your nozzle and you'll lose efficiency. If your nozzle is too big, the atmosphere will pinch your exhaust, and with enough pressure, you can potentially get flow separation from the walls of the nozzle, which can cause the exhaust to flop around inside the nozzle and potentially damage the engine. So, engine manufacturers need to find a sweet spot, particularly when it comes to sea level engines. The tough thing with sea level engines is that they don't operate exclusively at sea level. You inherently lose efficiency as you change altitude. We see this pretty often in the Falcon 9, where the exhaust plume expands very wide as it gets to the higher altitudes, which is not efficient. An air launch rocket can have a nozzle that's designed just for low pressure or vacuum environments and not have to worry about sea level air pressure or density. So, why doesn't everyone do this? Well, the problem is that this gets complex. Now you have to add an airplane to your fleet, which has its own costs and maintenance and things like that, and the savings that you get after all that is factored in is not much. There's also a scalability problem because this doesn't scale to larger rockets. Imagine the size of the plane you'd need for a bigger rocket. Virgin Orbit's platform is geared towards smaller CubeSats. It's not much of a competitor to something like the Falcon 9 or the Delta IV Heavy, but it's more directly in line with something like Rocket Lab's Electron rocket. But in further evidence of the cost problem, Virgin Orbit is performing these air launches at around $12 to $13 million per launch, while Rocket Lab is launching a more traditional rocket with the same capacity for only about $7.5 million per launch. Now, I do have to hand it to Virgin Orbit. Getting that down to $12 to $13 million is a huge achievement, especially when you consider that the Pegasus rocket is about $40 million per launch. So Virgin Orbit will be a great competitor for Rocket Lab, and I'm sure there will be customers at that price. So let me know what you guys think. Do you think Virgin Orbit will start to become a major player in the small satellite industry? I don't know. I'm excited to find out. As always, be sure to click the like button, consider subscribing, and I'll see you on the next video. Goodbye. Consider that the text doesn't scroll, and so I have no idea what I'm supposed to say next.